page 361. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His name, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The appointed psalm is 29. Please respond by whole verse. Ascribe to the Lord, ye gods. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord glory to his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of the holiness.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
He makes Lebanon skip like a calf, and then mountains like a young ox.
The voice of the Lord splits the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh.
The voice of the Lord makes the oak tree cry, and tears the forest.
the Lord. All are crying, glory.
The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forevermore.
The Lord shall give strength to his people. The Lord shall give his people the blessing of peace. A reading from Acts. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The gospel hymn is number 4 at 48. O love, how deep, how broad.
How fast is love? How fast?
repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Are the standard by which we live. And and that by which we measure all of scriptures against Jesus' words. And I believe that if we're loving like Jesus, and we use that as the measure of standard, by which we measure all of the rest of scriptures, both Old and New Testaments, that that's the basis, that's the measure of what we're called to be and to do. So that's why that one strikes me, that listening to Jesus and his words and using that as the backdrop or the standard by which we measure all of our actions, that's the standard, loving like Jesus. You know, there's that old phrase that you'll hear from some evangelical Christians. They'll say, what would Jesus do? Well, I'm not so much concerned about what would Jesus do. I know what Jesus did and what he said. And those are my standards. You know, loving like Jesus, not loving like Jesus might love, because then we get into the whole area of conjecture, and we don't know whether Jesus would have said something or done something. We just know from the Gospels, what he did and what he said. Anybody else? What word or phrase strikes you, and why?
The thing that struck me is the cause of the action that he baptized you with the Holy Spirit, and then Paul goes to the disciples subsequently and recognizes they have not been baptized with the Holy Spirit. He lays his head on them and baptizes them and gives them the gifts of prophecy. So it's an interpretation of that.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's reminiscent, isn't it, of confirmation that we have in our church. That baptism and confirmation is a reaffirmation of the vows that were made for us when we were baptized. Thank you.
Another thing I might say, if I'm not saying too much, is that there are some interpretations of some scholars who would say that Jesus was the only one that heard this. Uh-huh. That he's the only one that heard your words, the beloved that you have with me.
Right.
No one else would know who he was at that point.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the other Gospels, the baptismal, like in Matthew and Luke, we hear the words God speaking to the hearers. This is my beloved son, listen to him, would be to the crowd, the voice. And in this one, the voice you're suggesting is only to Jesus. Anybody else? Thank you. That's a very scholarly response. Thank you very much. Anybody else? Yes.
Just as often as baptizing is mentioned, that's something that sticks out to the people. I mean, it's the whole corner of that. John baptizing, and it's labeled out there in Ephesians, and Paul baptizing in Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thank you. Anybody else? What word or phrase?
Thank you. John the Baptist is one of my favorite characters in the Bible. I think I grew up with some people like him.
Yes.
But he... But he said that didn't take any credit for saving anybody with water. He said it was Jesus who had to do it with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
I always liked John the Baptist.
Yeah. Yeah. So with John, they only get water. With Jesus, they get water and the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
Okay. Anybody else? Thank you.
I'll throw out, to go along with what Bubba said, the word, when you ask just a single word, for me, it's in the beginning, the use of wilderness, and the fact that the voice is from the outside. It's not the establishment. And 1 John and Jesus are both outside of what's expected to be the institution for any kind of authority. Mm-hmm.
Good. Thanks, Stephen. Anybody else? And let's approach that second question. What is God in this passage saying to me? Again, I'll volunteer to go first and say, you know, that God is saying to me to listen to Jesus and the words that he says and the behavior that he does, and to love like Jesus would be my answer to the third question, is what is God asking me to do? Anybody else want to respond to that? What is God saying to me, or what is God asking me to do?
I think that God is saying that the water that we use in baptism is a symbol, but only a symbol, because the baptism really comes from the Holy Spirit, from heaven, from what Jesus is teaching.
Do is encourage you as a congregation to adopt this form of encounter with the scriptures. Today, I found that many times when churches explore the idea of Bible study, what you'll find in Bible study is, you know, I say it's this, or she says it's that, or they say it's this, and he says it's that. And I think Bible study can divide people, whereas something like the gospel-based discipleship, where you ask the questions, you know, what word or phrase strikes you and why, what is God saying to you, and what is God calling you or asking you to do, these words come from our hearts, and no one can say, well, no, it doesn't say that, because this is an encounter with the scriptures. It's a way of saying, this is the way the scriptures are encountering me, and I'm encountering the scriptures, rather than I'm studying this and it says this and it says that. So I encourage you, not only in your studies together, but also in times when you might just discuss the Bible with each other one-on-one, to answer those questions. You know, what strikes you about it and why? What is God saying to me? What is God calling me or asking me to do? And I think you'll find that the scriptures will become uniting rather than divisive. And that's, I believe, what we're called to do as a church, as we do in our baptismal promises, which we're about to reconfirm. Those five baptismal promises, I believe, are probably five of the most important questions and answers that we can have as Christians today. So let's stand, and on page 7 in your order, or 6 rather, you are baptismal vows. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil and renew your commitment to Jesus Christ?
I do.
You believe in God the Father.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
You believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
just a note there that you might not have noticed, but those are the words from the Apostles' Creed as opposed to the Nicene Creed. We recite the Nicene Creed every Sunday at worship, but those words for baptism are from the Apostles' Creed. Will you continue in the Apostles' teaching and fellowship in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, for God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil? And whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed upon us the forgiveness of sins, keep us in eternal life by his grace, in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 4. Let us pray for the church and for the world, for this parish, for St. Thomas Bath, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Rob, our bishop, and for Martin, our celebrant. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land away from gun violence, particularly remembering Perry, Iowa, and people of all nations, especially Russia and Ukraine, Israel and Palestine, other countries of the Mideast, in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, especially those with birthdays celebrated this week. Patsy Jones, Gretchen Simons, Kelly Newbern, and David Shields, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially those hurting from shootings in Iowa and elsewhere, those hurt by war, and those named on our prayer list. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, particularly Dickie Hoggard, whose memorial service will be held this Saturday, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people in the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may fly to your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
My dear friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Qualifications for this course. One of my colleagues put as his qualification literacy. I'm assuming that that applies to everybody in this parish, so you can read the bulletins in the back. I would simply say two things. We want to thank Martin for leading us in our service today, and I really want to remind you and stress the memorial service this Saturday for Dickie Hogley. We do remember Dickie, and we will remember Dickie. Thank you.
Thank you. Let us present our gifts and thank offerings to God. Offer to God a sacrifice of praise. Bring offerings and come into God's courts. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us. A fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
your command all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will that we created and have
from the primal elements you brought us forth to the human race, and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against once one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners.
And again you called us to return through prophets and sages. You revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood he reconciled us, by his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn.
From generation to generation.
Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you this day, and remain with you always.
Amen.
All right, who we have is hymn 616, Hail to the Lord's Anointed.